Welcome back to Collections in Context, where we will build on investigations into the archive as objects in the context of supporting new teaching and research practices. We have three speakers in this session. Firstly, Jacqueline Winston-Silk will discuss her encounters with a little-known collection of objects in the I.L.E.A. collection, received by Camberwell in 1989 and developed with funds from the Higher Education Innovation Fund, looking at its potential for use in teaching. Following her, Robin Christian will follow with an introduction to a photographic collection held at the University's Research Centre, Photography and the Archive. Looking at community-led photography in England in the 1970s and its potential for research. The third paper in this session will be introduced by Professor Nicholas Pickwood, who is the director of Legatus, a research centre at the university, which is leading work of international repute in the description of bookbindings, bringing to light discarded medieval manuscripts which were used in the construction of new bindings over the years. Jennifer Murray, a PhD student, will provide further context on this paper. So it's my pleasure now to hand over to Jacqueline. Thank you.
Hello. Firstly, I'd like to extend my thanks to Amanda Jenkins for inviting me here today, and it's a real pleasure to be speaking to all of you. I'm going to be talking to you about a project that took place last year, and I was based at Camberwell College of Arts. And as Sarah was saying, there was a project that looked at the historic Inner London Education Authority collection, known as I.L.E.A. And many of you might have had the opportunity to see some of the objects today, either in a handling session or in the cases that are around us. So the collection was donated to Camberwell in 1989, and in the years since its acquisition, it's had a relatively little use and critical attention. Seeking now to re-examine the potential of the objects within teaching and learning, and to address its responsibilities towards the care of the collection, Camberwell embarked on a pilot cataloguing project. So the project received knowledge exchange funding, and it was generously supported by the Higher Education Innovation Fund. This presentation will reflect upon the objectives, methodology, and discoveries of that development project in 2015. So to date, perhaps the most prominent intervention in the collection was the 1996 exhibition, The Camberwell Collection Object Lesson, which was held at the London Institute Gallery. And I know that there are people in the room today that was involved in that project. A collection of essays was published to accompany this exhibition, and it included work by Jane Pavitt, Paul Greenhash, Linda Sandino, Jean Adams, and others. The essays in that guide contextualise the collection within a broader discussion of the development of design education in post-war Britain. And I believe that that catalogue and that exhibition was a substantial contribution to our understanding of the significance of this collection and others like it. At the time, the exhibition Object Lesson was intended to serve as an introduction to the collection with the intention of promoting it for further research. And I like to think that perhaps last year's project was part of that legacy. So I have a confession to make. I am not a design historian, and I know that there are many of you in the room today that will know much more about 20th century design than I do. I approached this project wearing my kind of collections manager hat, and I'm definitely more sort of involved in the mechanics of curatorial and museum work, as opposed to design history. And so my awareness of the history of the collection was very much based in part on some of the research that was undertaken for that object lesson exhibition. And so I thought a good thing for me to do today was to share some of those ideas that were presented in that catalogue and give you a kind of brief introduction to the history and formation and creation of the collection. So the collection began as the Circulating Design Collection, which was part of the Circulating Design Scheme. And it was in operation from 51 until 1976. The scheme was initially established as a collaboration between the Council of Industrial Design and the London County Council. Coy initially managed and developed the scheme's displays, but it was envisaged that the London County Council would eventually take over its operation and administration. The scheme was intended as an experiment in design appreciation to teach children the principles of good design and discerning taste through the study of objects and materials. And that's key because the collection was a handling collection and it remains that today. It aimed to influence and shape the formation of children's aesthetic principles and, crucially, to educate children as potential consumers rather than as future designers. The Council of Industrial Design had a commitment to the circulation and promotion of design in an educational context. Its policies encouraged consumer awareness of both design and designer. Coyd influenced the education of public taste through its publications, films, and exhibitions. Britain Can Make It was held at the V&A in 1946, and it was a significant attempt to define what was meant by good design as a way of fostering economic regeneration in the years after the war. Coyd had also played an important role in the Festival of Britain. As early as 1946, and in preparation for the festival, Coyd had been compiling a card index of over 20,000 objects, over half of which were exhibited at the festival. And it was from this vast pool of British-made material that the first objects for the circulating design collection were selected. So the collection functions as a series of box showcases of objects. The ingeniously conceived travelling showcases had hinged doors that opened to reveal the display of products and raw materials within, and it was accompanied by literature and photographs. The travelling boxes arrived ready to display in London secondary schools. Each showcase would be duplicated six times, and this enabled handling and counteracted any accidental damage, replacing like for like. Therefore, bulk purchases were made, and as a result, I.L.E.A. became one of the most, or the foremost, patron of contemporary craft during this period. The scheme produced one of the most comprehensive collections of craft and design that was ever assembled for educational purposes. This was our working space at Camberwell last summer, and as you can see, we were literally surrounded by objects. People often talk about the extent of the collection, and I've heard numbers anywhere between 2,000 and 20,000 objects. And the reality is, at the moment, we simply don't know how large it is. So objects were purchased through major high street outlets, including Harrods, Liberty, and Heels. Some objects were acquired directly from studio makers and artisans, including studio pottery and textiles by Camberwell students and teachers. And this is a piece by Ian Auld, who was the head of ceramics in Camberwell in the 70s. A major supplier to the collection was also Henry Rothschild through his Primavera Gallery. The extent of the relationship between I.L.E.A. and Primavera can be kind of identified through the parallel connection between Primavera's exhibition programme and the acquisitions that took place by I.L.E.A. Almost all of the studio pottery and Dutch pastry moulds, South American crafts and Indian textiles were supplied through Primavera. Wooden objects were also acquired from the collection coming from the Commonwealth Institute. And objects were also acquired through the Good Award, the Good Design Awards and the Design Centre. In April 1956, Coyd opened its Design Centre on London's Haymarket. It was a permanent public space to present the display of contemporary British design. It became the main vehicle for communicating ideas to the wider public. In 1957, the Good Design Awards were established to promote the best in British design and to encourage retailers to stock certain products. Products were supplied to the collection which were recipients of this award, or those that had been selected to be displayed in the Design Centre. So I.L.E.A. adopted a specific display rationale for its travelling box showcases. Each one demonstrated properties of different raw materials and their use in manufacture. Displays explained the stages of design processes and elucidated technical terms. And descriptions were accompanied by real examples, and they referred to them as feelers, which is basically samples of materials or objects that could be handled by students. The early displays included letter printing and typography, metals and their qualities, glass and its qualities, and plastics at play in the home and at work. Objects were selected by I.L.E.A. to represent a number of ideas. Raw materials demonstrated the properties, textures, and finishes of objects. There were examples of finished products that demonstrate design principles. Objects were chosen that enabled to offer students a comparative study between machine-made and handcrafted items. There were also photographs which illustrated methods of manufacture, both historic and contemporary. And there were also tools of manufacture. By 1959, there were successfully 15 box showcases that travelled around London schools. And by this time, the scheme had become part of the working practices of I.L.E.A. In 1959, the Council of Industrial Design withdrew its involvement in the scheme as had been planned. A new arts officer, Dennis Stevens, was appointed. And Stevens was previously the deputy curator of the Jeffrey Museum, which is an institution that itself was quite renowned for its kind of museum education and its belief in learning through objects. This appointment saw a shift in the character of the collection. With the loss of the Council of Industrial Design's didacticism and sort of focus on fostering a strict agenda of design appreciation, the collection became much more eclectic. The idea of good design was still at its heart, but the idea of children becoming exercise consumers with an enlightened sense of quality and taste gave way to a collection which was much more aware of children's creative imaginations and in valuing the curious. Dennis Stevens arguably had a much more idiosyncratic policy towards collecting, and he broadened the selection of objects to include handicraft, pop art, and folk art. He included non-European art and craft, as well as objects that were chosen based on the value of their decoration. And new displays included things like household items from Japan, textiles by young designers, including those from at Camberwell, form in handmade clayware, pop, folk, and modern art, and items from Scandinavia. In short, the scheme itself was hugely successful, widely adopted, and it rapidly expanded, with new display boxes created every year. By 1969, there were 217 box showcases which were provided to participating London schools, and schools themselves were given a new display every term. However, the scheme didn't survive the 1970s. In 1972, the purchasing of objects was restricted, and the number of exhibits now exceeded that which could circulate in schools, and therefore the spending budget was reduced. The loss of the acquisitions budget meant that the collection became static, and was no longer able to be receptive to prevailing tastes. And ultimately, the scheme's role did not survive in schools. Indeed, once the value of this unique collection was recognised, its place in London schools was threatened. The sheer cost of protecting and administrating the vast resource contributed to the decision that it would be withdrawn from circulation. By the mid-1970s, the scheme was dismantled. And with changing government priorities, I.L.E.A. was abolished in 1990 as a result of the 1988 Education Act. However, in an attempt to salvage some of I.L.E.A.'s assets for the continuing benefit of students in London, a cultural review committee was set up, and it was at that point that the collection was saved and transferred to Camberwell. So this is just a short film that I took in one of the collection stores. And I think it kind of indicates the condition and variety and volume of material. This is one of several kind of storeroom locations. And if you look carefully, you might be able to see some of the duplication of some objects. I think there's some, as the camera goes around, there's some studio pottery on the left, just here, and you'll see there's sort of five of the same thing, and that happens all the time. And so really, what can we say about the legacy of a collection which I quote was deliberately and lovingly pulled together by I.L.E.A.? We can say that the collection remains one of the most comprehensive examples of post-war design. And as such, it remains an invaluable resource for the study of those disciplines' histories and offers an opportunity to examine the different pedagogic approaches to teaching of design. So I'll end this kind of introduction to the history of I.L.E.A. with a quote. This is a quote from Paul Greenhash, who was the course director of art design at Camberwell. And he's writing here about his first encounter with the collection in 1992. He says, "I imagined it to be a tired accumulation of stuff. I had no idea what was coming. I encountered hundreds of large crates, wooden and cardboard, stacked on specially built shelves. It looked like half the decorative art of London was stacked down there. I opened the first crate I came to, pushed aside the straw and tissue to one side to find a Lucy Reed soup bowl from the early 1960s. In the space of half an hour, I uncovered a decent slice of the history of British and European applied art." I think it's fair to say that my feelings when I first encountered the collection were not too dissimilar, and it was probably one that I can best describe as being completely overwhelmed. And that brings us to the project last year. So I'm now going to outline the project aims, discuss the challenges and opportunities that it presented, describe to you our process and method, and then end with the kind of impact of the project, and also briefly, if I have time, discuss some of its limitations. I'll also show you a couple of other short films as well. They're time lapses, and we time lapsed a lot of what we were doing and got a bit obsessed with it. So I've got a few here for you today. Anyway, so the project was initially funded for 3 months and was then extended by a month. So we had 4 months in total. And as is obvious, the project supported the development of the collection. And the collection was to be made accessible via a process of research, cataloguing, and digitization. And listening to people like Adrian earlier talking about the accessibility and the importance of accessibility, and listening to people like Ben talk about the idea of circulation, this idea of access is something that we're all quite familiar with, and it often sort of dictates a lot of collections-based projects. So the scope of the project enabled us to work with a small representative sample of objects. And really, we can think of it as a kind of prototyping process. The project contributed to a working model which will enable continuing improvement to the collections management through establishing procedures and making recommendations. The project also contributed towards University of the Arts London's commitment to object-based learning, its integration into course delivery, and further activity by researchers and a widening community of users. And finally, the impact of the project was measured through the Collections Trust benchmarking for collections care exercise. And where possible, we adhered to spectrum guidelines. I'm going to move on and talk to you about a few of the challenges that were faced by the project. I'm going to show some quite honest photographs, but I don't want to alarm anyone and say that it's not uncommon to find collections in the state that the collection is in, but what is important is that we address it, and that's something that Camberwell is doing. So one of the first challenges is that the collection is uncatalogued. We don't know the extent of it. The documentation that does survive is kind of piecemeal, and it is the result of various interventions and projects since 1989. And although these represent very positive attempts to inventory the collection, the information has not been synthesized and consolidated, and the information remains largely paper-based. And I'm sure you can imagine how difficult that is when you've got approaching 20,000 objects. Another challenge is that the collection sits across multiple sites, with some objects on loan. There's a lack of coherence even over the name of the collection, although we might possibly have a name now, we don't know. As I said, there's a lack of awareness over its size. And there's no location control over any of the objects. Perhaps one of the biggest concerns for someone like me who works with collections in museums is the physical storage of the objects was generally quite poor. So within the storerooms, there was no environmental controls. And as a result, a lot of the objects have succumbed to biological damage. Textiles and leather have been subject to mold, while paper-based objects have become brittle. Pest management was also an issue. It was not being routinely carried out, and pest infestation was prominent on a lot of the objects. Some had signs of moths. I need to catch up with my slides, are a bit slow. And that's an example of some
biological damage to textiles. Water had got into those. Another shot of textiles, dust and dirt. Here we are, here's up to the pest infestation. I'm going to show an image of a dead animal, just to warn anyone who doesn't want to see it. That's a sticky pest trap. Moths. So the environment the objects were in is very dry and warm. The area has also been flooded, so as you can tell, this is not ideal. Another concern of mine was that the standard of objects' housing was generally quite poor. The quote that I read from Paul Greenhash when he described encountering the collection in 1992, he talked about there being wooden tea chests. And these are what a majority of the collection is still in. So you can see that a lot of them have had absolutely no intervention in that time. And materials such as newspaper, bubble wrap, the wooden tea chests have been used for 20 plus years. Adhesive tape has been applied to some objects during transport and never removed. And in general, objects were stored with little buffering or support. As you can see, they were still packaged with newspaper from 1989, which makes me laugh. Some objects also got post-it notes on them. They're really packed in together. It's quite difficult to know what you're looking at. This is an example of what happens when bubble wrap is put on objects for a prolonged period of time. You get the impressions of the bubble against the fabric of the material. There were also objects that were on open shelving that had absolutely no protection. And talking about accessibility, to get to a collection store, you actually have to go up onto the roof of a building. Also, in terms of challenges, the past project that happened in 2015 did not have the scope to offer any kind of remedial conservation work. There are multiple stakeholders that are associated with the collection, which can make things quite complicated. There's a lack of web presence. There's also a lack of any dedicated staff post. So I'm going to move on now to opportunities. Let's talk about the positive stuff. So as I've said, the project has received funding. And I believe that there is now a real willingness and growing excitement about the collection from staff and students at Camberwell. And in reality, the objects themselves pose the biggest opportunity. They can tell multiple stories, and they have a unique provenance. The objects represent a capsule of aesthetic taste from mid-century Britain. They reflect a particular pedagogic approach to design and object-based learning. Multiple countries and cultures are represented, and they reflect a network and exchange of ideas within the Commonwealth. The collection is also significant in terms of British studio pottery and has an inherent relationship to the study and teaching of ceramics and also to the recent history of Camberwell itself. There's also a huge potential to engage UCL staff and students in the project. There's also the potential to possibly assign space to the collection. We're talking about storage space and display space within Camberwell's redevelopment plans. As we're at a university, I've also got an amazing access to subject specialist knowledge and to access from UAL conservation and technician staff. The project also had access to a limited number of original documentation. The project was able to exploit social media. And the project was also supported through two fantastic arts temps, who were a cohort of UAL students who get paid work. The project also saw the procurement of the museum system database. So over the 4 months, moving on now to talk about our process and methodology, we catalogued 600 objects. And the objects, this was initially our plan as to how we were going to approach selecting them. We selected them based on the idea that we wanted to show the breadth of the whole collection. So objects were considered in terms of their material, their designer, maker, manufacturer, their place of production, and whether they were examples of industrially made or handmade products. What also drove our assessment of the objects was their condition. In reality, we chose objects that were the best examples of their kind from the collection stores. It was a bit redundant for us to take objects that needed drastic conservation work because it was just beyond the scope of the project. In terms of the nitty-gritty of cataloguing, we wanted to acknowledge the provenance and the unique acquisitions history by retaining the original I.L.E.A. numbers. And these numbers have become the object's unique accession numbers. And it was quite easy to retain the numbers because the I.L.E.A. staff would scratch or pen or stick stickers onto the objects with their numbers. And they still exist today. And I.L.E.A.'s classification system was according to material type. And this was reflected in their numbering system. So G indicated glass, and coincidentally plastics, L for leather, P for pottery, T for textiles, and W for wood, and also basketry and paper. And we've retained and honored this taxonomic history. As we consulted more and more objects, we found that I.L.E.A.'s typology and numbering system contained a wealth of information relating to the structure of the scheme and to the chronology of acquisitions. So the first letter indicates the material type, as I've said. The three-digit number is the chronology of accession, so the lower the number, the earlier in the scheme. And then the last letter indicates the number of objects within a set. So as I said, objects were and display boxes were duplicated, so we had multiples of the same object. So where we've got a D, we know that there were at least four of that kind. And really, I think this idea is a potential for much more research. I'll talk over these time lapses, but this gives you an idea of the work that we were undertaking during the 4 months. So each object was catalogued and given an accession form. Each object underwent a condition assessment, and we produced a set of condition report photographs. A high resolution photograph was also produced of each object. And during the first phase, we were able to catalogue objects to a sort of basic level. And in that last month, in the extended phase, we were able to enrich object records through further research. I'll keep going. So in terms of the extended project and enriching records, we had time to consult and digitise the original documentation. And some of you might have seen the original archive photos and card records upstairs. And it's that I'm talking about. And after creating those digital assets, they were attached to object records on the database. And with a fine-tooth comb, I went through the old photographs and highlighted the objects that we had. Don't worry, I'm not drawing on the photographs, they're under plastic. But by doing this, it enabled us to trace object biographies and to show how they were originally interpreted and how they were contextualized within the scheme. We also indexed and numbered and rehoused all the original archive material. And finally, we improved the location control of objects. So running in parallel to the cataloguing project was a storeroom relocation. Work was undertaken to decant the objects from their existing locations, and they were reboxed and rehoused using appropriate conservation materials. For ease of access, objects were boxed according to type, and smaller boxes were used to group objects together. Where possible, objects were packed and buffered so that the contents of a box could be seen upon opening. And finally, all boxes have got unique numbers with unique locations so that finally they can be easily retrieved from the storeroom. So I'm running out of time a bit, so I'll skip forward. So this is our new storeroom. I hope you'll agree that it's a vast improvement on the last one. In terms of measuring the impact of the success of the project, let's move on. So we took steps towards improving the accessibility of the collection by engaging an audience beyond UAL through a series of activities which included a stakeholder event, social media, and facilitating visits to the collection. The stakeholder event took place on the 1st of July, where participants were engaged in a handling activity, much like today, and asked to generate ideas for the future of the collection. Through the process of sort of exploiting social media, we had 11,000 visits to our page over the lifetime of the project. We also facilitated research visits, including welcoming the Ministry of Curiosity, visiting artists, curators, and the studio we were working in also operated an open door policy so that staff from the university could drop by. We also wanted to measure the impact in terms of collections care. Benchmarking in collections care is a self-assessment checklist which sets out realistic benchmarks for the care of collections. And it's really a management tool which aids and assesses the planning of collections care activity. And we were focusing on storage, housekeeping, environmental monitoring, environmental control and conservation. So we're really comparing the state of the collection at the beginning of the project and then at the end once we transferred the new storeroom. And we jumped from 22% of all benchmarks being met up to 71%, which is a huge increase, but there's still work to be done. Moving briefly on to limitations. Of course, for the 4-month project, there's many things that we weren't able to achieve. I worked out that we had 996 staff hours on this project, and we couldn't achieve everything. The project itself raised a number of questions and further issues, and we turned these into a set of priorities and recommendations for the future development of the collection. So just a few of these. Future priorities to consider is advice from the conservator to establish a programme of conservation. Of course, seek further funding, that's always on everyone's list. Think about furthering the project and actually cataloguing the rest of the collection. Investigate TMS, which is the database training for Camberwell staff to allow students to access the material. Establish written procedures, continue to establish a web presence, and the list goes on. And finally, in the 6 months since the end of the project, Amanda kindly gave me an update on what had been done. And I'm pleased to tell you that objects have been used in workshops for BA illustration students. Independent students have accessed the collection within their own research. As a direct result of our advocacy for the collection on social media, we've agreed a loan of objects to St. Ives. And also a steering group for the collection has been set up. I know that some people from that group are here today. And crucially, that steering group has been established to safeguard the long-term future of the project and the collection. And also, I know that Camberwell has the potential to want to bring the collection back into schools and kind of reanimate its original purpose. Some photos kindly from Amanda of the recent use. And really just now to acknowledge the much wider team of staff that were involved in it, and just to say thank you very much, and I hope that you have the chance to see the objects, and just to say that it's one of the most exciting collections I've worked with, not just in terms of the individual objects, but also in terms of its stage of development, and I hope that Camberwell, wish Camberwell every success.
Robin, I just wanted to quickly say thank you to Sarah Mahurter and Wendy for organising this. I'm going to talk for about 8 minutes, if you could let me know when it's 8 minutes, and then I'm going to show you a short film. So I'm going to talk about two collections that we have at PARC, which is Photography in the Archive Research Centre at LCC. One is Camerawork, and the other is called the John Wall Archive of the Directory of British Photographic Collections. Camerawork collection has a unique content which tells a fascinating and largely untold story of community-led photography in England during the 70s, 80s and 90s. The collection also contains material from Cockpit Arts, which was in Holborn, and the Half Moon Photography Workshop, which is what came before Camerawork. It's a significant body of prints, posters, correspondence, business reports, negatives, transparencies and objects. These charts the original proposal for setting up Half Moon, a community-based photography workshop in East London, right through to Camerawork's extensive publishing and touring programme. Early Camerawork exhibitions included those by Nick Hedges, Martin Parr, Anna Fox, and Ed Barber. Originally, Camerawork was a small volunteer-run gallery. It evolved to housing a publication and a channel of affordable touring shows, which were sent out in boxes with actually suitcases, laminated prints that people could pay what they could afford to host. So it's a very accessible way of getting material out. Publication challenged readership about perceptions towards photography, reassessing photography's role within society, and often dedicating whole issues to a particular subject, such as the Lewisham issue, where images and press responses to the National Front March of 1977 were examined by the publication. Camerawork evolved around a left-wing ideology and collective, ever political. Both would change over time, and the magazine would publish its final issue in 1985. Show you some more. This is the office. This is the magazine. A couple of issues in the magazine early on. And this is the director of Half Moon Now, called Chris, who's just been in as one of our researchers. I'm going to move on to the John Wall papers. The papers were donated to the centre. Researcher Bob Pullen's work on the Directory of Photographic Collections in the UK, which is basically a digital version of what John Wall was trying to do originally, and it's still ongoing. For some years, the filing cabinet which held the Wall papers was stored in the centre's small office and was inaccessible, but the opening of an archive room in PARC's new space at LCC in 2014 made it possible to begin to examine the papers and build research into a unique 1970s project. One of the things that we wanted to do was to see how we could make sense of this mass of papers and bring it to life. The archive is mainly made up of letters from Wall to archivists and collection managers, responses to the appeal for information about collections, and hundreds of file cards. Making a collection of file cards, letters and minutes of meetings come alive is no easy task. And because of this, we examined ways in which we could bring to life this collection, make it more user-friendly and visual than that of the Camerawork papers. John Wall was an enthusiastic amateur photographer, a Doctor of Divinity, and a committed member and later fellow of the RPS, the Royal Photographic Society. In 1972, the group suggested the compilation of a National Photographic Record. The Directory of British Photographic Collections was published by the RPS in 1977. In the introductory section, Wall noted that the directory provides a comprehensive account of all the photographic collections of note in the British Isles in response to a widespread need felt and voiced increasingly in the world of photography at large. He was at pains to point out that every kind of photographic collection has been the subject of this inquiry. None has been excluded from our consideration, private or commercial, personal or open to public view, published or unpublished, historic or contemporary, negatives, copy negatives, or positive prints and transparencies. In the introduction, Wall stressed the instability of the photo collection, noting that, like the units of a conventional book form library, the units of a photographic library can be removed, dispersed, transferred to other collections, begged, borrowed, and even stolen. There is an unstable quality about even the most apparently permanent of photographic collections. What we have done is fix or record a collection at a particular moment in time, just as a photograph of, say, a moving object is itself a moment frozen in time. The directory took Wall 4 years to complete. Although he was the beneficiary of the files collected by a number of other records, including the proposed register of photographic surveys of British buildings in the Isle, register of photographic surveys of buildings in the British Isles, and Colin Osmond's planned National Register of Photographic Archives, most of the research was carried out by Wall and his team. The Sunday Times launched a campaign to help to fund the work, and the RPS published and sold sets of reproductions of the photographs from the Society's collection to provide extra income. I'll just skip here. Some of the collections which Wall listed have since disappeared as unique entities, Some will have been absorbed into larger collections, other donated to libraries and museums, and some of the personal collections may have simply ceased to exist. John Wall could not have foreseen the advent of either digitisation or the corporate and institution absorption and blending of collections. He could not foresee globalisation when individual companies would become part of conglomerates, leaving their archives at the mercy of corporate decision making. The directory remains, as Wall predicted, a moment frozen out of time. I'll show you the film. And there is sound in it that comes in halfway through.
Please note, the term photographic collection in the accompanying questionnaire is used to indicate collections of photographs of whatever kind, private or commercial, personal or open to public view, published or unpublished, historic or contemporary, negatives, copy negatives or positive prints, whether or not copyright in the originals or reproduction rights are held by some other person or body elsewhere. It is thus an all-inclusive term, and we hope that you will feel able to complete the form in respect of your own collection accordingly.
G. Crosby, FRPS, 45 King's Avenue, Woodford Green, Essex, 22nd of August, 1972. Dear Sir, I'm interested in the announcement in the current photographic journal regarding the proposed Dictionary of Photographic Collections and wonder whether my qualifications would be of any use. I retired from advertising 12 months ago, diploma member of the IPA. My work covered all aspects of printing production, leaflet and brochure writing, and editing, typography, layout and makeup, photo engraving, proof checking, etc., and also studio administration.
March 28th, 1974. Dear Mr. Crosby, thank you for your letter of 23rd of March, and I'm delighted to learn that you're able to visit us on April the 27th. I appreciate your reasons for wishing to take the earlier train, and I'll meet you at the barrier at 11:31. Thank you for your clear description of your good self, which will enable me to certainly identify you. I regret that I am in appearance and dress quite indistinguished, but I will wear a green National Trust tie to facilitate recognition. Looking forward to seeing you. With all good wishes, John Wall.
September 22, 1980. Dear Dr. Wall, a little over a year ago, Mrs. White of the Public Archives of Canada, London office, made some inquiries about Frederick Daly on my behalf. I shall now take the liberty of writing to you myself. I would very much appreciate any information that you might be able to provide. Thank you for your kind cooperation. I look forward to hearing from you, and I shall notify you of the glorious day of publication. Yours sincerely, Joan M. Schwartz, Photo Archivist, Acquisition Research, National Photography Collection.
It is therefore clear, as you surmised, that the London Stereoscopic and Photographic Company was in the same vicinity as Robert Bentley and Sons at 136 Cheapside during the period circa 1859 to 1862 that Frederick Daly worked there. If I can be of any further help with archival queries, do not hesitate to get in touch. With all good wishes, yours sincerely, Dr. John Wall.
Dear Dr. Wall, the printers seem to be sending proofs of the directory in dribs and drabs, so I'll just pass them on to you as I receive them, if I may. Here are the otoliths of entries 290 to 681, the set of proofs with running heads and the proformers.
As I say, I shall put the proofs in the post as they come in. Yours sincerely, Elizabeth Blair.
Mr. John St. John, William Hyman Limited, 15 Queen Street, Mayfair, London, W1X8BE. 12th of August, 1974. Dear John, thank you for your two letters of 10th of July, and please excuse this delay in replying. This has been due partly to my absence from the office on holiday recently, and partly to some small difficulties we have encountered in assembling the material desired. Directory of British Photographic Collections. I'm encouraged to learn that you hope to find an American publisher for the directory at Frankfurt. Please find enclosed my latest general description of the whole work. Please feel free to amend or reduce this as you think fit. I've drafted this in the form in which I imagine a publisher's description might be cast, but in this I may be mistaken. I'm also enclosing a few sample entries as requested, but in respect of the specimen pages, on black and white since we prefer this format, we have not yet received 6 complete sets as requested from Mr. Rodwell. In the light of the time factor, I am asking Mr. Rodwell to forward these directly to you. If you require any further material, please do not hesitate to get in touch. Thank you for your clarification of the question of communications with Mr. Rodwell. I found your guidelines very helpful and will abide by them in the future. Certainly, if I feel at any time if we at the office are getting out of our depth in this field, I will let you know at once. I think it would be useful if we could meet, even if briefly, in London in the fairly near future. I'm wondering, however, if this could be deferred until my return from a period away from home, which lasts from August 17th to 31st. With all good wishes, yours sincerely, John.
February 1978, John Wall, Esquire, Ashfield, 45 Middleton Lane, Middleton St. George, Darlington, DL21AA. Dear John, Directory of British Photographic Collections, thank you very much for sending me the recent review from the Northern Echo. Certainly a very good one. It just goes to show that some strikes are worthwhile. The sales for working directory...